Every sinew in Trey's body stood up to be counted, as he once again shoved at the drum. This time, it upended, tumbling away from him and right into Jason's path. The giant looked down to see his own legs consumed with flame. The lashing inferno had already set about devouring his lower half and was making its way up his huge frame. Welcome back, everybody. Today, we're going to delve back into Friday the 13th Hate Kill Repeat, starting with Chapter 8. Darkness was descending over clear waters. The sun was handing over to the moon, which now had to contend with thick slugs of gray cloud. The trees around the former crystal lake stretched in all directions, appearing thick and impenetrable in the fading light. A modest town center, which some locals laughingly referred to as downtown, nestled to the east. To the north, the Phoenix Heights Hotel dominated the landscape. It was by far the area's largest building, painfully out of place alongside miles of sprawling greens and browns. The absence of moonlight, together with the low wattage of lamp bulbs, which lined walkways at ground level, made the lake itself resemble a black gulf, a hole where the forest heart should be. In the area covering a mile's radius around the water, the odd campfire glimmered like a beacon. Not 20 feet from one of these, Jason Voorhees stood silently. Moonlight weakly illuminated one side of his mask as he watched the scene before him, his huge hands empty by his sides. Through the gnarled trees and bushes, figures gathered around a bright, fierce flame, which snapped at the air. Jason's eye followed them as they moved, dancing around the fire. Not all of them were dancing, however, two set aside from the group. Jason's gaze fastened on one in particular. Her long, dark hair framed a petite face that was being propped up by her fists. She appeared the group's most vulnerable member. Her flesh would rip with ease. Her bones would offer no resistance before they splintered and cracked. As he watched, his breathing quickened and deepened, his jaw working angrily behind the mask. Besides the intruders, the woods seemed entirely silent and still. Yet he had caused a whole world of panic, simply by standing here. In the earth that surrounded him, 1,000 insects swarmed over each other in droves, increasingly desperate to escape his aura. Some were too slow, and the evil overwhelmed them, rendering them dead husks in a ready-made grave. Oblivious to the effortless carnage he had brought about, Jason's eye continued to stare, unwavering, unblinking. Halo should have become used to the spectacle, yet the bizarre primal ritual never ceased to amaze her. Normally, it would also amuse her. This evening, however, it was merely something to keep her mind off that possibility that the fleeing killer might cross their path. She kept remembering Denzella's prophecy, the storm, the man-child. Halo, have a goddamn beer! For something like the 10th time, she gave Trey a firm no, citing the fact that she didn't feel well. Again, he shrugged and turned around to laugh some more. Looking back, she was sure Denzella had been talking about Trey. He would have become the storm if she had told him about the baby, a storm which would undoubtedly try and force her to have it terminated. So maybe Halo had changed the timeline by not telling him. She had Shona to thank for that. If she and Basket hadn't broken their own news, Halo might have already told Trey. The evening would have become even less pleasant. Trey was naked apart from his Daffy Duck briefs. Halo shuddered. Not because he had a bad body, no, not at all, or even because of that duck's grinning face, but because she knew what he was about to do. The fire still burnt fiercely in the oil drum, yellow and orange flames lapping a good foot above the metal rim. Trey regarded it with a mixture of hunger and determination. Basket and Duke were following his train of thought, no doubt due to man's inbuilt communication with his fellow man. Perhaps it was done by a type of osmosis, she thought. Testosterone floated through the air and shared idiotic thoughts with other guys. "What the hell is he doing?" asked Shona, still perched on the log beside Halo. Trey was staring at the drum, one foot comically scraping the ground like a bull's. "Do it for metal!" yelled Duke. He and Basket began clapping their hands, repeating the mantra. "Do it!" Trey broke into a sprint toward the drum. "Trey, don't, please!" yelled Halo. She was too far away to stop him, so that was the best she could muster. Trey reached the drum and leapt into the air. His legs split like an athlete taking a hurdle. Halo held her breath. He hit the ground awkwardly, stumbling, then rolling onto his side. Halo could see him grinning, so allowed herself to exhale. "I know he's your boyfriend," murmured Shona, "but he's a jerk." "Sure is," said Halo, returning to the log. "I'm just worried about what they're going to do to top that little performance." "Naked!" cried Duke, as if answering her question. "We've got to do it butt naked!" The women shared a sigh. Shelley always knew when she had drank too much. She started saying too much. Words would begin to fly out of her mouth, and that would have been much better off tethered inside the part of her brain marked too much information. This stranger, Norwood, had only joined her 10 minutes back, and he already knew all about her tryst with the hotel manager. He seemed to be a good listener, but Shelley knew that she was ranting at him, letting off steam. This would be a mistake, as he was one good-looking guy. He surely didn't want to hear all about her dumb heartache, did he? "So, he broke it off with you today, my dear?" asked Norwood, frowning sympathetically. "Is the man going blind?" Shelley flushed at the compliment, along with the fact that he really did seem interested. Still, she resolved not to keep talking about it. "I think it's best if I forget all about it," she said. "I don't want to burden you with it, you poor guy." "No, no," said Norwood, gently wagging a forefinger and pursing his lips. "You, my dear, can burden me all you like." "Thank you." "No, not at all. Now tell me, do you make a habit of sleeping with staff at your workplace?" Shelley was surprised by his sudden inquisition, but didn't want to let it show. "No, I don't," she said breezily. "That was a first for me." Norwood examined her evenly. There was something going on behind those lovely eyes of his, but Shelley couldn't decide what it was. Disapproval? Lust? Secrets of his own? "Good for you, my dear," he finally said, pulling a silver cigarette tin from his breast pocket. "Do you mind if I smoke?" "No, not at all." "So what's a fine, cultured gentleman like you doing in Clearwaters?" Norwood flicked a Zippo lighter open and drew on a long cigarette until the tip glowed orange. "Why do you ask? Do you see this as a dead-end town?" "Yeah," she smiled, "full of no-hope people doing no-hope things." Norwood still said nothing. He craned his head back slightly, made a circle with his mouth, and exhaled. A smoke ring emerged from between his lips and softly floated upwards. For a second, it hung above the man's head. Shelley briefly thought of her sister and how she really should get in touch with her. She felt bad about effectively forcing the girl to move in with that jerk, Trey. Norwood's eyes entranced her once again. Sensing that he didn't intend to make any further comment, Shelley changed the subject. "How long are you here for?" "I'm not sure. Probably until the FBI catch up with me." After a pause, Shelley laughed nervously. Norwood's deadpan expression cracked down the middle, and he followed suit, chuckling softly. Another pause. Shelley took a large sip of her cocktail and threw caution to the wind. "Which room are you in?" "They got you in a good one, I hope." "I'm in a suite on the 13th floor." Shelley rolled her eyes. "Oh, not that floor. The designers made a big mistake when this place was built. Clayton still has not got around to fixing the room numbers. You're not superstitious, then?" "Not remotely," he said. "There is no such thing as bad luck. It implies lack of responsibility. Everyone should be made to..." He hesitated as though choosing words with care. "Everyone should take responsibility for their actions." Shelley eyed him curiously. "Wow, I can see that you're very serious about that." "I am indeed," he smiled. "But I also like to have fun. Do you like to have fun, my dear?" He leaned in toward her, sucking the tip of his cigarette. She smiled back. The flush across her face began to spread, downwards. Larry Bruckenheim felt like the king of his castle. It was a feeling to which he was well accustomed, except he was no longer in the corporate environment. He could enhance the feeling with a large dose of alcohol, maybe women too, if he found a discreet opportunity. Over the years, he'd lost count of the number of loose dames he'd banged in expensive suites, then politely ditched before breakfast. His wife knew nothing. He finished his second scotch and ordered another from the cute bartender, whom he had tried and failed to engage in conversation. He had played the usual tricks of not so casually mentioning that he was an MD, but none of it seemed to have translated into much interest in those gorgeous brown eyes. Ego tarnished, he sullenly looked around the room. The lounge was filling up, mostly with Intrax employees. He did his best to remember their names, but generally he bluffed his way through with hearty slaps on backs, or suddenly feigning distraction when it came to introducing someone to someone else. Then he saw her, a woman, perhaps in her 30s, perched on a bar stool on the other side of the room. Her legs were crossed, making her short skirt ride up to display maybe half an inch of stocking top. Larry was mesmerized by the sight. Stockings were his big thing, particularly when they were being used to tie him to bedposts, but made a special effort to wrench his gaze upwards, back to the face. She was quite beautiful. Furthermore, she was looking directly at him and smiling. Larry smirked and sipped his scotch. He waited a few minutes just in case this hot little number was with anybody, perhaps one of the jackasses lined up at the bar waiting to order, dollars in hand. As if realizing that he was waiting for a green light, she raised her eyebrows. The message was loud and clear. What are you waiting for? Sufficiently full of Dutch courage, Larry left his stool, grabbed his drink in one meaty paw, and heeded the siren's call. Ping! The elevator doors glided smoothly open. Shelley wasn't about to tell Norwood, but this wouldn't be the first time she'd had sex in this suite. When her and Clayton's fiery loins governed passion had been at its peak, they had embarked on a tour of vacant hotel rooms, screwing until they collapsed, laughing and glistening with sweat. She was excited, yet strangely nervous. This new man seemed so respectable that she could barely imagine him having sex at all. He somehow had the chastity of a minister, despite his flirty playboy act. It was a direct contradiction which made him hard to predict and seriously turned her on. This could be very interesting, she thought. As Norwood slid his keycard into the door's metal slot, he turned to glance at her. Somehow she realized he had managed to give this simple act a sexual overtone. It seemed that the minister's robes were about to come off. Larry could not believe his luck. He had attracted many an envious glance from his Intrax subordinates, as he and Penelope chatted in the lounge. She, he had learned, was a novelist who liked to travel around America, pinning her latest sex and shopping blockbuster in a non-stop variety of hotel rooms and restaurants. He'd never heard of her. Penelope Thawn didn't sound familiar at all. But bullshit was his inherent specialty. The woman was convinced that he'd seen her on numerous talk show appearances and even read one of her novels while on vacation in Milan. He would soon have her between the sheets. No one in the company would ever breathe a word either, on pain of being ejected faster than a drug addict. So, tell me about yourself, Larry, she said, brushing one immaculately manicured hand against his right knee. You're the boss of this great big company, but what about your home life? Are you married? Luckily, thought Larry, he wasn't wearing the ring. The road was clear for some straight-up deception. No, he said, glancing around the room to make sure no one was within earshot. Never found the right girl, I guess. Plenty of time for me. Penelope smiled, but for a moment he felt her pale eyes searching his soul. It was an uncomfortable feeling, as though she knew full well he was married and had been testing him. He swallowed hard, wondering whether she had spied the strip on his ring finger, where his suntan became altogether more pale. Damn. As he turned to pick up his drink, tiny muscles pulsed on either side of Penelope's finely crafted cheeks. When he swung back to face her, she was smiling again. Of course, she said. Where's the rush, huh? Larry nodded and chuckled. He was feeling unaccountably nervous, but when she replaced her hand on his knee and kept it there, his momentary unease was forgotten. I'm glad you're not spoken for, Larry, she said with a delicious pout. I think we should have some fun. He stared at her stupidly. This was taking him back to high school. No matter how robust his ego had become on a corporate business level, Deep down, Larry was always surprised when a woman wanted him. Shelley gasped as her blouse buttons popped beneath Norwood's clever fingers. For all of this man's classy charm, he had soon dispensed with the pleasantries, once the door to his suite had been closed. Turning to kiss her with a passion that made waves course through her body, his hands had roamed her curves. As they lay on the king-size bed, he nuzzled her breasts, which were bulging out of a black bra, while fingering the clasp on her back. "Beautiful," he breathed. "Quite beautiful indeed." Shelley only moaned in reply as his mouth fastened around one of her nipples. Larry frowned as Penelope pushed the button marked 13.
"There's really a 13th floor? Usually..."
"Hotels don't have them," she said, finishing the sentence for him as the elevator doors glided together. "Is this a problem?" She wrapped her arms around him and pulled herself so close that he could feel body heat through the thin material of her dress.
"Oh, no," he said. "Not a problem at all."
His emphasis on those last two words was increased by the fact that her hand had snaked inside his trousers and was doing things to him that made all words irrelevant. Her lips brushed against his neck, making him shudder. Larry found himself drifting on a sea of delights, only roused from it when a loud ping signaled their arrival. "We're here," said the love goddess whom he knew was going to make his year. "Come." They walked a short distance along the corridor, Penelope maintaining a light grasp on his hand. Then she produced a key card and opened the door to her suite. Pushing it inward, she gestured for him to enter first. He found himself in a large living area, typical U.S. suite material, with comfortable, multi-cushioned sofas and a suitably oversized television set, complete with a VCR. Oh, the 80s, such a great decade. Behind him, the door clunked shut. It was fun time.
"Take your clothes off, darling," she said, breathing into his neck. "Then I'll take you to the bedroom."
Larry did not hesitate. He tugged furiously at his shirt as Penelope looked on, a smile playing on her lovely lips. His pants and the rest soon followed, until Larry stood naked in the middle of this strange woman's hotel room. Trying to stand in his most confident, manly pose, stomach in, chest out, he hoped to God that she liked what she saw. Penelope reached over to him. He thought she was aiming for his hand, but soon inhaled sharply as she grabbed something far more intimate. Then she slowly walked away, tugging him very willingly in her wake. When they reached the door to what Larry assumed was the bedroom, she once again ushered him in first. He did so and gasped at what he saw on the bed inside. A couple's lower halves were partially covered by blankets, but Larry could nevertheless see that they were having sex. They lay on their sides, the man spooning into the woman. Hadn't Larry seen her in the bar earlier, from behind? Her eyes were tightly closed, but his were fixed on Larry, hard and cold. Larry was confused. He was severely turned on, but didn't want this. He hadn't signed on for group sex, just some quality time with Penelope. As he tried to turn away from the bed, her arms grabbed his, holding him firm with the strength belied by her size.
"Watch them, Larry," she said. "This is what we'll be doing, very shortly."
He frowned, feeling uncomfortable with the situation and unnerved by the man's gaze. This stranger was smiling, but this wasn't the smile of a happy swinger. If spiders could smile, when flies struggled against silken bondage of their webs, they could look exactly like this. Yet Larry couldn't take his eyes off the scene. The woman on the bed had heard Penelope speak and opened her eyes. She looked startled and attempted to pull away from the man, but he held her still forcibly.
"Come now, my dear," Norwood told Shelley. "Let's not make any snap decisions."
He placed the palms of his hands on either side of Shelley's face. With one smooth movement, he wrenched the woman's head to one side. There was a sickening crack. Larry's jaw hung low as he struggled to take in the information. Nausea rose fast from his guts as he watched the woman slump back on the bed like a broken doll. Grinning, the man continued to gyrate against her.
"Slut," he said into the corpse's right ear. Then he turned to face Larry. "And shame on you, sir, for watching."
"He's a married man, darling," Penelope called over to Norwood. "He wanted to fuck me." Larry's legs finally became operational and he turned to run. Penelope blocked the doorway, her eyes possessing a terrible, righteous fire. He instinctively shrunk back from her, but she immediately took a step forward.
till death do us part, she hissed. What happened next was a blur to Larry. It looked like the woman had swung a punch at him and missed. Then he felt the agonizing pain across his throat, the blood running hotly down his chest. The dizzy terror as his brain was starved of oxygen. He slumped to his knees with a splutter, vaguely noting the dripping knife in Penelope's hand before the floor rushed up to meet him. Quickly, said Norwood, abandoning the body in his bed and jumping across the room. Into the bathroom with him. That's a fine carpet, and I don't have it tarnished with a sinner's blood. I still can't believe the depths to which the human race is prepared to sink, panted Penelope as they dragged Larry's corpse. It makes me so mad. I know, my dear, but we're doing our best. Look at it like donating to charity. You can never give enough, but every cent helps. Norwood tugged the shower curtain to one side. The pair wheezed in unison as they heaved Larry Bruckenheim over the bathtub's rim. When they returned a minute later, they were carrying Shelley Harlan's body. No one seemed to know how the fight had started, least of all Duke and Basket, who were having it. Halo was too jaded to join Shona in the traditional chorus of protest. She was beginning to suspect that all this pugilism might be an attention-seeking exercise. Intervention never yielded positive results anyway. By this stage of the evening, the two men were simply too drunk to respond. They were like dogs that had been set on each other, with what remained of their brains having been set to kill. They were also naked as the days they were born, complete with minor burns attained from jumping over the blazing oil drum. Halo vaguely recalled that the argument had flared over who had leapt over it the highest. Any excuse would do, really. In the clearing, thankfully a fair distance from the fire, the brothers had spent a few minutes taking it in, turns to shove each other backwards and forwards. Their eyes were glazed and unfocused, their balance unsteady. Yet neither fell over. This was an ugly battle of wills. Duke threw the first punch, missing Basket's head by inches. Hey, said Trey, that's enough, guys, cool it down, okay? Halo looked over to see Shona crying. She put an arm around the girl. Don't worry, she said. They'll stop in a minute. They always do. In response to Duke's attempted blow, Basket ducked past the larger man's defenses and swung a fist of his own. This one connected with some force, striking Duke under the chin and practically lifting him off the ground. Time seemed to miss a beat. Then Duke stumbled backwards, his balance gone awry. He thudded into the dirt, dazed and instinctively grabbing his chin, slowly working his jaw to check that it still functioned. Oh, shit, said Trey, turning to Basket, who was staring down at his prostrate brother, clearly ready to fight some more. What did you have to do that for, man? Baby, said Shauna, between sobs, please don't fight no more. Everyone watched as Duke slowly pulled himself to his feet. He stood up straight, eyes fixed on his brother. Come on, guys, said Trey, holding his hands up. No more. Duke looked around the camp, from person to person, as though seeing complete strangers. Finally, he murmured, Fuck you all! He lumbered out of the clearing before anyone could speak. The woods had claimed him. Basket sat by the fire, his chest shaking as he laughed. He'll be back, man! Don't you worry, he'll be back! Chapter 9. Ed Daimler knew that his sense of priorities was all ass backwards. His task was to halt one of America's most brutal killing sprees in living memory. He had no ID on these people, just a fairly flimsy profile at best, together with the belief that they might be heading for Crystal Lake, Clearwaters, or whatever the fuck it was called nowadays. Despite all this, he was struggling to focus on the subject. He needed a drink, and he was damn horny. These two factors seemed to override the case at hand, which worried him. It also concerned him that his hands were shaking. Luckily for him, Van Stat was at the will of their Lincoln Grand Marquis, so he was able to sit beside her with his arms folded, hiding the evidence of his condition. He was praying for the next service station, so that he could visit the restroom and take another life-saving gulp. At least it was the evening, and therefore a more respectable time to drink. There was less guilt involved. In some ways, he quite liked the clandestine nature of his booze habit. It reminded him of his short-lived cocaine period over 10 years back. As much as he'd initially liked the rush of the drug itself, he had also got off on the whole process of closing the cubicle door, chopping out the drug, then mastering the art of flushing the cistern at the precise moment he took his illicit snorts. Ultimately, his then-wife had put a stop to all of it. "Kick the coke or I'm out of here," she had told him. "You become a jackass." Daimler smiled weakly to himself as Van Stat expertly maneuvered through the commuter traffic on this jam-packed highway. Jackie had eventually left him, even though he waved goodbye to hard drug use. The affairs had finally worn her down. She was not a woman to be messed with, and he had messed with her, big time. When she heaved her suitcase out the door, he had no one to blame but himself. God, how he wished he had Jackie, or just a Jackie, to kick him into shape these days. She would be going through his pockets, then throwing away the miniatures and the mouthwash. She would remind him of what he was supposed to be doing, and the huge responsibilities that came with his job. Most effectively of all, she would tell him how proud she was of him when he got his act together. Somehow, when Daimler lived alone, the addictive sides of his personality rose to the surface. Casting another sideways glance at Van Stat's legs, he felt sure that she was fully aware of his attention and was about to reprimand him at any moment. Daimler grabbed the car phone again. "We're supposed to be the FBI," he said. "Can't even get the damn phone to work." "You sure you're using it right?" As much as he desired Van Stat, her smug habit of assuming him to be an idiot was starting to wear thin. "Of course I am," he said, eyes boring into the side of her head. "I pressed the right fucking button." What was he doing, snapping at his partner, cursing at her? He felt sweat run cold at the base of his spine. "Get a grip, asshole." Van Stat glanced at him strangely. "Okay, Ed, look, are you all right?" He sighed, feeling like a little boy. He just wanted her to stop the car, cradle him to her bosom, and tell him everything was going to be fine. Then maybe give him a little head. "Sorry, Mel, I'm fine. Just a little tense, okay? I'm always like this, until the job's done." He knew full well he was lying. He wasn't always like this in the least. He was renowned as being a level-headed professional, reliable and pragmatic. Not some edgy fuck-up liable to bite partners' heads off at a moment's notice. "Damn it," he said, banging the phone on the dashboard. "Let me try this again." Van Stat said nothing. She kept her gaze fixed solely on the road as Daimler jabbed the phone's illuminated buttons. "What are you trying to do anyways?" she asked. "Get through to the sheriff's office at Crystal Lake. At least make them aware that our unsubs are on the way." Van Stat clearly wanted to reiterate her concerns that he was making a big assumption. He could practically see her biting her lip as she checked the wing mirror, prior to switching lanes yet again. Maybe it was time to cut her some slack. "Might be on their way," he said. "I admit, it's a risk. But what else do we really have?" Before she could reply, he found himself with the working phone line. The sheriff's office picked up after more than 10 rings, and a gruff voice greeted him. "Deputy Kenny Riger." After explaining who he was, Daimler cut straight to the chase, telling Riger to get as many men on patrol as possible. "So we're looking for a couple?" "Most likely," said Daimler. "Possibly an older couple. Almost certainly married. I'm sorry that I can't tell you much more. This won't be much help, but I'm 90% positive that these people won't look like killers."
"They never do, I guess," said Riger. "Thanks for the call, sir. I'll make sure the sheriff gets this message. You can rely on us."
"That guy sounded half capable," said Daimler after disconnecting the line. "Called me sir, too. Makes a change from the usual territorial pissings we get from small-town forces. You ever get that, Mel?" She shook some hair away from her eyes. "All the time. I'm a woman, too. Don't forget it." Daimler laughed, looking her up and down. "How could I forget?" The comment was meant to be humorous, but his fractured state of mind made the words spill out in a seedy fashion, desperate even. The car fell silent for the next few miles.
"Fucking fuckers!"
Duke had no idea where he was going. All he knew was that every step took him further away from the campsite. That was good enough. Branches and leaves lashed at his face, despite his best attempts to intercept them with his hands. A black canopy hung above him, as trees conspired to block the moon from view. His head felt heavy, but he had the gung-ho attitude that a run of shotgun beers always assured. He also had a full bladder and a belly full of hatred for his asshole brother. Struggling to remember what the argument had been about, he came up with nothing. but felt certain that he had been in the right. He always was. He was the older brother with the most experience in everything, whereas Basket knew nothing. Duke frowned and stopped in his tracks. The sound had come from behind him, between his own footsteps. He listened for a second, then turned around to look back along whichever path he had carved for himself. He saw nothing, literally nothing. No matter which way he faced, he could barely see his own hand in front of his face. For a terrible second, he wondered if he had finally drunk himself blind.
Basket, you fucker! Is that you? Come to give me some more shit? I wouldn't advise it, man.
No answer. Maybe the sound had been an animal, or a branch that he had unwittingly wrenched from a tree while protecting his face.
Come any closer, and I'll piss on you, he said, breaking into a deep, booming laugh. Get you with the old fire hose. See how you like that, bitch?
He listened again, hearing nothing at all. Then he fumbled the front of his jeans, tugging the zipper down. Taking himself in hand, he began to emit a powerful stream, which made him sigh with relief. There was a wet pitter-patter as his urine splashed over leaves and cascaded down from one to another. This time the sound was closer, behind him again. He groaned as he tightened muscles, bringing the flow to a premature halt. Silence returned. With a grunt, he once again let nature take its course. Bladder empty, he stood there in the darkness, considering his options. Even through the booze, he had enough sense to know that he would have to return to camp at some point. He might be a stubborn son of a bitch, but he didn't like the idea of sleeping, rough in the middle of the woods. No, he might as well head back. He made his point. He would go back and call Basket an asshole, maybe even crack open a beer with him and forget all about it. Then he'd continue his top-secret mission to steal Shona from the guy. It dawned on him that he'd lost all sense of direction. How many times had he turned around? Just the once? Twice? More? He turned to his right in order to avoid walking into the piss-soaked bushes. Then he broke into a stride, devoting effort to steadying his nerves. Duke was not a man who felt much fear, but some semblance of doubt had begun to gnaw at his bravado. Something struck him hard across the face and he stumbled backwards, dazed, hitting the ground. There he sat, slowly shaking his head, soon realizing that he had walked directly into a low-hanging branch. He would have to be more careful. He dragged himself back upright, using a tree for support. His face throbbed painfully. Had he broken his nose? It sure felt that way. Something fast and immensely powerful slammed into his stomach, bursting effortlessly through his flesh, burying itself deep inside him. He wheezed, his eyes widening but seeing nothing new, as the fist moved around inside him, grabbing, tugging. The pain was unbearable. He vomited as the fist was wrenched back out of him. Duke felt something wet and sloppy wrapping itself around his throat, barely registering that it was a stretch of his own guts. He weakly lashed out at his assailants, but to no avail. The reeking tube was tightened around his throat like a garrot, squeezing mercilessly until he slumped to his knees, hands spasming feebly by his sides. A final savage blow to the head sent Duke spinning down into the wretched mess that caked the soil. I hope he's been murdered. Basket lay fully naked on the ground of the clearing, the back of his head propped up on the log previously occupied by Halo and Shona. He held his latest beer over his genitalia, solely because Shona insisted that he do so. Trey sat cross-legged next to Basket, staring at the oil drum's flames. He was bare-chested in jeans.
Shut up, dude, he said. Shouldn't be saying shit like that. I mean it, man. Shrugged Basket. I hope he's run into the guy the police were after. That would teach him.
Dickweed, said Trey. He dropped an empty beer can which hit Basket on the side of the head. The women were walking around the campsite's perimeter. Halo felt like a caged animal. When she really stopped to think about it, she had been caged ever since she left her sister's care and moved in with Trey. Her eyes glistened.
Hey, you okay, girl?
Shona gently rubbed Halo's back with one hand.
What's the matter?
Halo thought for a moment, then glanced over to check that the men could not hear. Halo turned to face Shona. Once again, she decided not to tell the other woman about the baby.
I don't want to be here, she said simply. You and me both, girl. But let's just sit it out, huh? At least try and make the best of a bad situation.
Halo stared out of the clearing into the darkness that appeared solid, like it had been painted onto the wood. It's a bad situation, all right, she thought. Why can't I help feeling that Duke really isn't coming back?
I really don't have anything suitable for the woods, darling, said Penelope Thawn, perched on the bed. I should have planned ahead better.
Wear what you have on now, Norwood straightened his shirt collar in one of the suite's numerous mirrors.
It's a dry enough evening. If conditions worsen, I shall carry you. How's that?
Penelope fluttered her eyelashes at him as she stood, reaching for her elegant jacket.
You're so romantic, my dear. Let's hope we can find Jason tonight. I think we'll make a good friend in him.
You have more faith in our compatibility than I, he said, holding open the suite's main door and waiting for her to step through.
But I'm certainly willing to give it a try. The man does seem to be on our wavelength.
Let's tune in, she said, disappearing out over the threshold. As Norwood Thawn followed her, he picked up a piece of cardboard from a small side table, then shut the door. The Thawns strolled off the Do Not Disturb sign, swinging gently on their door handle.
Hey, where did Larry go? Asked Tom, looking around the lounge bar, his vision only slightly compromised by the few bottles he had downed.
Greg, who had been contrived to sit himself at the bar between him and April, turned back from ordering yet another large gin and tonic and smirked.
Why do you ask, Tom? Looking for an ass to park your tongue for the night?
Tom ignored him and sipped his beer. Then he sighed as Bill Beller, a new Intrax recruit who was proving even more irritating than Greg, sidled over to join them. As usual, the horribly slick grin was plastered across the kid's face.
Hey there, cats!
He said, for some reason. Beller referred to people as cats, as if he was some kind of blues man. He certainly had pretensions to such a status, forcing anyone within reach to listen to his appalling, home-recorded demos.
Did you see who Larry went off with?
Nope, said Greg.
He didn't like Beller either, possibly because the pair of them was too similar for comfort.
But I'm sure you're about to tell us, gossip boy.
I sure am. Larry hit it off with that hot older broad who was sitting across the room. The two of them started getting pretty friendly as far as I could tell.
So what? Asked April, propping her face up with one hand.
Larry does that all the time. All of Intrax knows it.
Oh, said Beller, looking genuinely surprised.
Right.
Thanks for the exclusive, though, laughed Greg. Go off and spread it around, why don't you?
Beller smiled awkwardly.
Catch you cats later, he mumbled. A few of us are going down to the woods for a smoke.
He threw them the grin of a man who believed marijuana to be highly radical, before slinking off across the lounge.
Prick, said Greg, spitting the word into his glass.
Basket was pacing around the fire now, still naked.
He's been a long time, he said. He never takes as long as this. I should go look for him.
Put some fucking clothes on first, dude, Trey said with a grimace. You're turning my stomach.
Stay here for God's sake, said Shona wearily, looking miserable as she shoved near the campsite's perimeter,
rubbing her hands together in an attempt to keep warm. The temperature had dropped dramatically, even though their oil drum continued to burn.
We don't want to lose another.
How long do we have to wait before trying to find the police? Halo said aloud, back on the log, watching the flames.
Maybe the police already found Duke, said Trey, walking around randomly, waving his arms like airplane propellers. He was in a pretty bad state, man. They might have arrested him, thinking he was that killer guy.
Basket groaned and fell over, hitting the ground hard. Trey started to laugh, then saw what had made his friend topple. Lying on the ground beside Basket was a human head, crudely severed, as though it had been torn from the neck. From where Halo was sitting, she could see only the back of the head. But it was Duke's. She knew it was Duke's. Trey and Shona were goggling at it, hands cupped over their mouths. Basket sat up, wondering what all the fuss was about, rubbing the back of his neck, which the flying head had evidently struck. Seeing his brother's dead eyes staring up at him, he howled, hands scrabbling at the dirt as he attempted to put distance between himself and the head. Shona finally found it in herself to scream, her whole head shaking as she did so. Trey lost a battle with his stomach and bent double, throwing up on the ground. All Halo could do was sit there and stare at Duke's head, as her worst nightmares were realized. Denzella's words echoed through her brain, the warnings of imminent danger, the man who would bring the storm. In the corner of her eye, she saw movement, rapid movement. She heard Shona scream again, more urgently this time, as if there was an immediate threat to them. Turning slowly, Halo saw a giant striding purposefully from the woods, seeming to melt out of the black. A hockey mask wrapped around his face, the figure was unarmed, but there was no question that he had killed Duke and further intended to kill every last one of them. Halo's legs felt weak beneath her as she sprang up from the log. She was the closest to the intruder, who was rapidly gaining around on her. Jason's hands flexed with the anticipation of ripping the girl apart. He changed direction slightly, heading straight toward her. Jason heard his mother's voice.
They must be punished, Jason, for what they did to you, for what they did to me. Kill for mother.
Jason quickened his pace, raising his arms. Halo stumbled backwards, eyes wide, the breath catching in her throat. She knew that no matter how fast she moved, she couldn't outrun this maniac. She was dimly aware of Shona screaming again and some terrified yelling from Trey, Basket, or both. It was like she was in a trance. Her legs were failing her as though their muscles and ligaments had been rendered to jello. He was so close that she could see one eye through its mask hole. It blazed with the cruel spite of youth. This was the man-child, she knew instinctively, and it was about to take her life, fulfilling Denzella's prophecy. Then Trey was standing beside her, grabbing her by the shoulders, forcefully rotating her 180 degrees and barking in her ear like a rabid dog. Run, you stupid bitch, run! The world switched back out of slow motion. Halo took off like a rabbit from a trap, not stopping to look at anything or anyone. Once a scary mass of the unknown, the trees were offering vital sanctuary. She buried herself in them, ignoring the scrapes and scratches that she was dealt. The only important thing was to get as far away from the clearing as possible. Behind her, back at the campsite, heart-rending sounds of terror scalded the air. Trey roared defiantly as he grabbed one side of the oil drum. The flames lashed up at his face as he strained against it. The drum was now the only thing that separated him from Jason. Help me! Trey called back over his shoulder. He was hoping that Basket would appear at his side to help him tip the drum, but nothing happened. He and that useless girlfriend of his had deserted the campsite. It was down to him to face this freak alone. For a second, he considered turning tail himself and making good with his feet. It wasn't too late, he was a fast runner. But then what? Running through the darkness with this bastard trailing him? Better to try and stop him. Every sinew in Trey's body stood up to be counted, as he once again shoved at the drum. This time, it upended, tumbling away from him and right into Jason's path. The giant looked down to see his own legs consumed with flame. The lashing inferno had already set about devouring his lower half and was making its way up his huge frame. Burn, you motherfucker! Breathed Trey, standing back and watching his handiwork. Burn! The flames were savaging Jason's torso, preparing to lap at his head. Trey's grin faded only when it occurred to him that while this guy was on fire, he didn't appear to trouble him unduly. That's when Trey decided to turn and run. As if sensing that his prey was about to flee, Jason stomped toward him with immense strides, taking one of his arms in a paralyzing grip. Trey could not believe the giant's speed and strength. Jason slung another arm around his back, wrenching the man toward his own blazing body. Trey shrieked as the fire ate him alive. For a minute, the two figures resembled one blazing torch, Trey struggling feebly. Soon, the intense heat melted his nerve endings, and he fell limp in Jason's merciless grasp. The giant manipulated the blackened, broken corpse like a toy, using it to extinguish the remaining flames on his back. With a barely audible grunt, he tossed Trey's body aside and looked around the empty campsite. Then his big feet were punishing the soil once again. He was back in the shadows. My Life, Part 2, Growing Pains. I'll never forget the look in Walter Cusp's eyes shortly before his fate was sealed. Neither will I forget the reason why he deserved to die. After the relatively pure environment of elementary classes starting off in middle school felt like being thrown into the wild. It was a source of conflict, both among the other children, who generally fought like rats, and within my own mind. On one hand, I enjoyed the education. I enthusiastically stuffed my young head with every form of knowledge I could get my hands on. I fed on information like others chewed their precious candy bars. Why? I could practically feel the boundaries of my brain expanding just as fast as the sugar addict's gut. Mr. Patterson made the already interesting subject of science a true joy, while Mr. Allington attacked his math teaching with a joyous fervor for numbers, calculus, and the cold, hard beauty of the fact that couldn't fail to rub off on me. To be quite honest, there wasn't one subject at Primetree Middle that I didn't like. The downside of education, needless to say, was the fact that I had to be surrounded by other humans. I hesitate to describe them as humans, but that was the traditional term for these walking slabs of gristle, greed, and sin. All around me, I saw children gorging themselves, fighting, and worst of all at our age, indulging in early experimentation of a lustful nature. Ironically, I always thought Walter Cusp had been one of the good guys. His family took him to church every Sunday, a tradition he seemed to welcome. During recess at school, he and I would exchange notes from classes we had missed and generally have a meeting of minds. He struck me as a high-minded kid, above and beyond the fleshy, grubby debasement of his peers. Like me, he was 11 years old. Unlike me, he had a mop of red hair which hung down over his eyes. Irritatingly, he made little effort to brush it away while talking to me, rendering the sight of his eyes quite an occasion. In retrospect, that hair was just a shield he used to hide his true nature from me. We started hanging out after school. We lived in the same neighborhood, even rode much the same kind of bike. My father didn't mind too much as long as I didn't lapse on my studies. Besides, he knew that I had been taught far too well to stay from the righteous path. One blazing summer afternoon, Walter and I were lazing around on the hillside, which overlooked the Castlebrook Shopping Mall's forecourt. We could sit there for hours, our bikes splayed out on the hill beside us, watching the ants bustle to and fro from their cars, loading up on the latest vehicles for their gluttony. The mall seemed to shimmer in the heat. "Look at them," I told my friend, nodding down toward the shoppers. "They're so pathetic." A pause. "Who?" he asked, speaking through the single reed of grass which poked out from between his teeth. For an intelligent child, Walter was often very slow on the uptake. Deliberately so, I often suspected. "Them." I stabbed a finger down toward the forecourt, a hot feeling growing in my stomach. "It's just greed upon greed, Walt." "I think the mall's kind of cool." Before I could turn and put him right, as I already had on numerous matters of the world, he sat up, his face suddenly shot through with glee. "Hey, I made out with Betsy Goldman." He grinned, expecting the same reaction back. Thinking fast, with the hot feeling inside reaching meltdown proportions, I gave him what he wanted. "Way to go, man," I said, slapping one palm against his. "What exactly did you, do?" "We kissed, and she let me touch her tits, and other stuff for a while before she stopped me." Right there, right then, I felt like ramming my fingers through Walter's stupid, wide eyes and tugging out his diseased brain. We were kids. This idiot couldn't even keep his sins under control until he reached his teenage years. Not that there was ever any justification for that kind of business, outside of holy matrimony. Instead of killing him, I smirked back like the average young boy might. I smirked, filed away the information, and consciously cooled the anger in my guts. I would bide my time. The Weinhard Mine System, I discovered in the local rag, was to be reopened, no doubt to be transformed into some gaudy roller coaster, rather than being used for its original purpose. Anyway, work had already begun. One day, toward the end of summer, I showed Walter the page that I'd torn from Dad's newspaper. We sat on the edge of a fast-flowing river as the horizon slowly dirtied, transforming from pure blue to angry orange. Since Walter made his unwelcome revelation, we hadn't hung out so much. Whereas we would normally ride our bikes 2 or 3 times a week, I saw him once a fortnight. Walter seemed puzzled by this change, but at that age you don't ask friends why they've cooled off on you. The slut Betsy Goldman had also cooled off on Walter, hearing that stories had begun to circulate about her, about her virtue, or lack of it. She refused to so much as look at the boy.
Walter stared at the monochrome photograph of the mine's front entrance. "Cool," he whispered.
"Bet there's treasure in there,"
I said, casually gazing at the sunset's intense glare.
"Even cooler," he grinned. "Let's go in and get it."
"Don't be stupid," I said, feigning shock as though the idea had never occurred to me.
"We can't do that, can we?"
Walter is walking ahead of me in a corridor hewn from black rock. The only light comes from our torches. The mine is closed for the night, but has been very badly secured. Two skinny kids like us are making short work of edging past all these hastily nailed planks and signs. Whenever Walter turns to make sure I'm still there, I'm being unusually quiet for some reason. I see excitement flickering in his eyes. No, scratch that. Not excitement. Greed. The boy is a sinner, both in terms of material goods and pleasures of the flesh. This reminder only serves to strengthen my resolve. We ventured quite a way down into the mine, along sloping, low-ceiling tunnels, which seemed to be solely propped up by thick wooden posts. Every once in a while, a piece of rock will fall from the ceiling and we hesitate, half expecting the whole shebang to come down on our heads.
"How will we know when we find the treasure?" wonders Walter, still ahead of me, his back shining brightly as it takes the brunt of my torch glow.
He hangs a right. Peering beyond him, I see that the tunnel ends, maybe 15 feet ahead. Walter's eyesight is less acute than mine, so he keeps on walking. I remain at the junction, guiding my torch upwards to study a wooden prop and its relationship with the cracked ceiling. Walter's voice, which is several feet away, says,
"Looks like a blind alley, huh?"
I take a step back, then swing my right foot, slamming it into the wooden post with every ounce of strength I can muster. The kick is so triumphant, it's as if some kind of higher agency is flowing through me. The post snaps away from the ceiling and I stagger backwards, throwing myself out the way. The ceiling piles in immediately, as do large portions of the walls. A glimpse of Walter's shocked face made even more pallid by his torchlight. Then rock and rising clouds of dust replace it. I pick myself up and inspect the damage. The fallen rock is so dense that I can barely hear Walter cuss screams. When I was younger, Dad showed me how to bury live rats in the larger size matchboxes. Walter's pathetic mules take me back to those happy days. As I make my way back up through the mine, I kick another two posts down behind me, just for good measure. Don't want anyone opening the tomb too soon, after all. Just over 2 hours later, I'm back home, my face a mess of soot and tears. A police officer is sitting at our kitchen table, gazing at me sympathetically.
"We were looking for treasure," I stutter. "Walter ran in a wooden post in the ceiling. The ceiling."
I stop short and cry my little heart out like the pain is simply too much. "Walter Cusp, you could have been my friend forever. But no, you had to go and burn in hell."
Okay, this has been chapters 8 and 9 of Friday the 13th Hate Kill Repeat. It was also part 2 of Norwood's journal that it pops up part 1, 2, 3, pops up after every few chapters. I decided kind of halfway through Norwood's journal part 2 there to go ahead and do it in his voice since it is his thoughts. Sorry that half of it was in like a regular voice and the second half was in Norwood's voice, but I thought it fit more to do it in his voice, so that's how I'm going to do it going forward. Unless y'all don't like that, let me know in the comments section. You guys are the ones listening. I want you to be happy and to get what you want to hear in these audiobooks. I'm actually enjoying the story so far. Hope y'all enjoyed the little snippet of Pamela's voice there in part of the narration tonight. It wasn't exactly what the book said she said, but it was close enough that I went ahead and used that actual audio clip from one of the Friday the 13th movies. Thought y'all would like that, instead of me trying to do a "Killer, Mommy!" type of Pamela voice thing or whatever from the movies. "Killer, Jason, killer!" I just don't think I can do Pamela's voice.
Anyways, guys, thanks for listening. If you haven't done so already, please subscribe, click that like button, click the bell so you always know when new chapters are dropping. Let other people know, please spread that word out there. Drop me a comment, I love to hear from you guys. Check out the Facebook group page, there's one more day left on a drawing I'm going to do. All you have to do to win it is enter the Facebook group, join the group, and answer the question in a private message to me. How was Meredith killed in Friday the 13th, Church of the Divine Psychopath? As soon as you answer it correctly, I'll put you into the drawing. The winner is going to receive a Friday the 13th hockey mask plushie and the DVD, two-disc set of His Name Was Jason, 30 Years of Friday the 13th documentary. Alright guys, until next time, this has been your friendly neighborhood 80s slasher librarian saying, thanks for listening, and...
They must be punished, Jason. For what they did to you. For what they did to me. Kill for mother. Steal, steal.